everyone. I'm Kanza Khan. I'm a Meridia intern, and today we will be talking on how to conduct a systematic review and meta-analysis. This video has been compiled along with Dr. Malik and Dr. Tariq. So without any further delay, let's get right to it. A systematic review is a type of review that uses repeatable analytical methods to collect secondary data and analyze it. It is a highly rigorous review of existing literature that addresses a clearly formulated question. What are its types? There are three types. The first type is qualitative. In the qualitative type, the results of the relevant studies are summarized, but they're not statistically combined. In the quantitative type, you have statistical methods in which you combine the results of two or more studies. In meta-analysis, you use statistical methods to integrate estimates of effect from relevant studies that are independent but similar, and then summarize them. Now, whoever is writing a systematic review or a meta-analysis should be aware of PRISMA. What is PRISMA? What does it stand for? PRISMA stands for Preferred Reporting Items for Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis. What is it? It is basically a website that helps authors improve reporting of their reviews and meta-analysis. Now, PRISMA has a checklist. The PRISMA checklist is basically a 2-to-3-page, 27-item long checklist, which I've attached in the slide for everybody to look at. And let's just go and have a look at the checklist. So here's the checklist. There's core information, such as administrative information, introduction, and methods, and the details and everything that you have to mention in your review or analysis written underneath it. You can go through it whenever you're willing to write one. Moving on, why are we doing systematic review or meta-analysis in the first place? Three main purposes have been mentioned. First of all, they keep clinicians up to date with the latest evidence. It evaluates the benefits, risks, and harms of healthcare behavior and interventions. And finally, gives summaries of previous research for funders wishing to support new research. Okay, so now we will be exploring the steps of writing a systematic review. I've listed them down here, and now we will be going through each and every step in a little detail. The first step is topic selection. First of all, find a good and specific topic, since there would be limited research papers on it. First of all, formulate your hypotheses, the question you want to test. Identify that research question and avoid general topics such as management of diabetes and hypertension. Now, why is that? This is because there is already far too much data on it. It's been explored quite often and it's quite redundant. Next up, choose your medical specialty in which you want your research article to be published in. It should preferably be in your specialty of choice. Now, examples of good and specific topic are management of glycemic control in ICU patients. Second example is a thalamic infarct, where the right-sided or left-sided is more common. Now, journal selection. First of all, select which journal you want your research article to be published in. Then go to the website of that journal, specific journal, and then read the author's guidelines. First of all, also find out if they even accept systematic review or meta-analysis, because not every journal does that. And then pay specific attention to requirements such as word count, font size, number of pages, all of these details. The first step is choosing the right journal. There are five factors to look at when choosing the journal you want your article to be published in. The first is the aims and scope of the journal. Find out if the aims and objective of your research article align with the aims and scope of the journal or not. Next up is the impact factor. Impact factor is a measure of the frequency with which the average article in a journal has been cited in a particular year over a span of 2 years. Cite score metric. The cite score metric is the average citations per document over a span of 4 years. Peer-reviewed. What does peer-reviewed mean? Peer-reviewed means when journal articles have gone through evaluation by journal editors and other expert scholars who critically assess the quality of the article. And finally, indexing status. Indexing status is a journal that has been listed in a database, for instance, PubMed. A PubMed indexed journal means that it's a good quality journal. So here are the author's guidelines by the Journal of American Medical Association for a systematic review. without meta-analysis, and then purely meta-analysis. The requirements are listed as the words, the number of references, number of tables, a Prisma-style flow diagram, as you can see right here, which I mentioned earlier, and then a subtitle, including a systematic review in it, a structured abstract, key points, and following the Equator reporting guidelines. Similarly, for a meta-analysis, they've asked for similar things, but Prisma reporting guidelines. Here is an article, which is a systematic review as well as a meta-analysis, association between BCR-ABL tyrosine kinase inhibitors for CML and cardiovascular events, major molecular response and overall survival. So here you can see I've highlighted that the systematic review and meta-analysis, the subtitle mentioning both these things is written here. Then here is the structured abstract having, you know, all the objectives, the study methods, inclusion, exclusion criteria, results, conclusion. And finally, a Prisma flow diagram, which they asked for in the author's guidelines, has also been mentioned here. Next up, you set the inclusion and the exclusion criteria of your study, which determines whether or not a study will be included in your research or not. Examples of the criteria would be study population, study design, intervention types, comparison, measured outcomes. Now, the third step is searching on PubMed. But what is PubMed? PubMed is a free search engine for accessing the Medline database for references and abstracts. So basically, think of Google, but for research. That's what PubMed is. So go to pubmed.gov and then start with your PubMed search process. So first of all, your research topic, you should find about 15 to 20 keywords associated with your topic. Let's just assume we're talking about thalamic infarct. In thalamic infarct, keywords would be like brain infarct, venous infarct, vein of LeBe. Go ahead, put them in the search engine and search on PubMed. And now you're going to get a number of articles. You have to record those number of articles. Here, just for the sake of discussion, we're assuming you get 500 to 1,000. Now, recording the number of articles is vital, and why we will be discussing at the end. So, after those 500 to 1,000 articles, the next step is title review. As the name suggests, in title review, the articles are discarded on the basis of the title. So, you read the title. For example, you searched for gallbladder duplication and you got an article on renal duplication. Then, automatically, that article will be discarded on the basis of the title. So starting with those 500 to 1,000 articles, we are now left with 50 to 100 articles just because we've discarded some on the basis of title. Again, keeping a record of the number of articles is vital, and I will explain that in a bit. Okay, so after the title review, now the chosen articles, the 50 to 100 articles that you are left with, you will find out the abstracts of those and print those abstracts. You thoroughly review the abstracts after that and discard the ones that are irrelevant to your topic. For instance, the 100 articles that you had, you read the abstracts of those, you discarded 85 out of those, and now you're left with 15. Now you have to get your hands on the full-length articles of the chosen abstracts. You read them in great detail, you find the ones that are relevant to your topic and discard the ones irrelevant to yours. And then this should bring the total number to about 8 to 10 articles, and these 8 to 10 articles are the main focus for your research paper. They will help you write your research paper. Next up is this Prisma style flow diagram, which basically does the same thing. It's simplifying the process and you can have a look at it. Now we will be talking about the parts of a systematic review. I've listed them right here: the abstract, introduction, materials and method, discussion, conclusion, and references. Now we'll be discussing each part in a little detail. The first is the abstract. It is usually short and structured. It has the following details such as background, aims and objectives, methods, results, conclusion. The inclusion-exclusion criteria is also mentioned in the abstract. After the abstract is a short, brief introduction. The purpose of the introduction is to emphasize on why a particular topic was chosen, why you're doing the research on this topic in the first place. The end goal or the purpose of the research is mentioned in this section. The materials and methods section. This section describes the whole process of attaining the relevant articles. The entire methodology is described in this section. And that is the reason that I initially told you to keep a record of the number of articles, because that whole process of finally getting to the final filtered articles is mentioned in this section. In the discussion section, the entire research is summarized. Authors with previous research papers on the same topic are mentioned, as well as their findings. How their findings support or contradict your research is also discussed in this section. Next up is conclusion. In conclusion, the limitations of the research are mentioned so that they're not repeated again. Suggestions for future researchers, as well as upcoming research projects, can also be mentioned in this section. Lastly, references. In this section, you mentioned the references. You can use RefWorks, you can use EndNote, Zotero, Mendeley, or you can do it as manually as well. References are extremely important. Make sure you don't miss out on even a single one. Why? I will mention in a bit. So now we're going to be talking about meta-analysis. What is meta-analysis? It is basically a step ahead of systematic review. It's a statistical combination of the results of multiple studies. So basically, meta-analysis is a statistical combination of the data that you have compiled and derived from a systematic review. The steps to writing a meta-analysis are similar to a systematic review. But now we'll be talking on what the difference is. The difference is very basic. It's just including a statistical analysis portion to the methods section. Mention the software that you've used for analysis, for instance, Excel. So here is another systematic review and meta-analysis example where I've highlighted the portion in the methods section, and this portion is a statistical analysis portion, which makes a review a meta-analysis. So how do we conduct a meta-analysis? Using previously filtered research articles, such as the 8 to 10 articles that we had originally narrowed down for the systematic review, we'll be using those research articles and we will be extracting the data from these. For instance, an article has 25 patients, the next has 35, the first article has about 50% females, the next has about 45. So all this data will add to the Excel sheet and then take an average of these. In this way, you can find out different things such as the mean age and different factors like that. Flow diagrams, graphs, and forest plots with confidence intervals can also be included to support your findings. Mention which studies supported or contradicted your topic in the discussion, and at the end, write the results of your analysis after summarizing all your findings. Before ending, I would like to talk about plagiarism. Plagiarism is basically a word-to-word transcription of someone else's work and then passing it off as one's own without any acknowledgement. It is highly unethical, can have dire consequences such as loss of a person's professional reputation. It can also have legal consequences, and it is taken extremely seriously in the US. Causes of rejection. So sometimes you do send an article and it gets rejected by a journal, and we should be talking about why that happens. The top causes are that the paper is not relevant to a journal. For instance, you're submitting a radiology paper to a cardiology journal or a cardiology paper to a radiology journal, so automatically that will not be accepted. Then there's improper formatting. Now, what do I mean by that? By improper formatting, it's that you've been given exact guidelines in terms of structure, headings, images, captions, tables, and you don't follow that. So again, that could lead to rejection. Finally, using inconsistent or wrong English, grammar mistakes, errors with punctuation or expression. And for this, it is recommended to go through a book called Elements of Style, which you can go through, and that would help a lot in terms of how to write a research paper. And another cause is topic not unique enough. In some cases, what happens is a topic has been researched, so it's not anything special. That could also lead to rejection. Screenshot of a book called The Elements of Style. It's vital that you read it once to get an idea of on how to basically write a research article and the format to follow. After this, we'll be discussing a couple of pointers before we end the whole thing. Always formulate a hypothesis, the first that you want to test. Then make sure that the journal you're targeting, whether it's a systematic review or an analysis, just make sure that it accepts that. Again, make sure there are no meta-analysis on that specific topic to avoid duplication of effort. And meta-analysis is something that you can't do with just 3 to 4 articles. A minimum of 8 to 10 studies might be required to conduct it. This brings us to the end of our video. Thank you so much for watching. And if you have any more questions, please let us know in the box below. Please subscribe to our channel and keep watching.